We have a very eminent person, Professor Sandeep Bansal, who is the head of the Department of Cardiology at Safdarjung Hospital, a very busy hospital, and get a lot of patients of STEMI. Dr. Sandeep Bansal has a tremendous contribution in management of STEMI by intervention as well as by drug like taniactive place. Sandeep, I have a very important question to you, and we are taking subset of patients,
right?
How to manage STEMI,
right,
in difficult situations.
Yes.
So I'm sure in a place like Delhi, we have so many diabetics,
right?
We have so many metabolic syndromes, we have so many hypertensives, and there is a subset of population with CKD,
right?
They have end-stage renal failure, or they are having a very compromised renal functions,
right?
And if such patient come to you in a Safdarjung hospital emergency with an ST elevation MI, we like to know from you as a message or as a protocol, how should we manage these patients? Are they candidates for an intervention like PTCA, angioplasty or stenting? Are they candidates for a bypass surgery? Are they candidates for a drug like taniactive place? Or we treat them only conservatively, or we can do nothing and just watch. What's your opinion?
Right. The management of ST elevation MI in a patient with chronic renal failure would be essentially, based on the degree of severity of the renal failure. As a cardiologist, I have learned to practice this. The apps are easily available on all our smartphones, and I also instruct my residents to do so. The first thing is to get to the EGFR of the patient. So if the EGFRs are prohibitively low, which means that they are less than 30 ml, we are aware that nothing is really contraindicated as such. You can still go ahead and do an angioplasty and do a procedure, provided you have a backup of renal replacement therapy in the form of dialysis. So really, there's no real limitation as such. But the thing is, you have to be aware of it, and you have to be conscious about what problems you can encounter, and go ahead and foresee those problems and manage them. So for example, if the EGFRs are over 30 ml, that essentially means the European Society of Cardiology says that you multiply it by a factor of 3.75. So that means you can give up to about 110 ml of dye in such people without, in the background of good hydration and, giving them good hydration and doing them in a better kind of state, we can do an angioplasty also in them. But then the dye is the limiting factor. If the EGFR is less than 30, then we have to alert our guys of hemodialysis, and that this patient might need hemodialysis. So you can do the procedures, but in a run-of-the-mill situation, in a very routine kind of situation, many a times we are not able to do that. Again, we have to weigh the pros and cons in terms of pharmacotherapy.
Dear friends, I think, as I already mentioned to you, we have with us Professor Sandeep Bansal from Delhi, a very busy cardiologist from Safdarjung Hospital. You just heard a few minutes ago, he gave his viewpoint on how to manage patients coming in the emergency with STEMI with an underlying almost end-stage kidney failure. Let's listen to Sandeep Bansal, his message and the protocol which he recommends what we should do in a setting of CKD or a renal failure in a patient who come with the STEMI. Dr. Sandeep Bansal, please give your message and protocol how to manage such patients when they come in emergency, so that we can protocolize and give this instruction to all the emergencies everywhere in India, how we can manage our patient to the best of our capability in a situation like this, in CKD with kidney failure.
Right. The first thing is to be able to judge whether the patient is really in chronic kidney disease or not. And because there can be situations where a person has a very severe acute ST elevation MI, and because of renal hypoperfusion, there is a rise in the creatinine. And that distinction is pretty much simple. We all know that ultrasounds are available, and so with the help of the kidney size and cephalopelvic differentiation, those are the two important features that we look for. We can know whether it is an acute renal failure or a chronic renal failure. So the subset that we are referring to right now is those patients who have chronic kidney disease, as we talked. The second step is that based on the creatinine that we have, that we get, we need to calculate the eGFR in these patients. And as we are aware, we again don't have to keep this in our minds any longer. They are available on all the smartphones. The apps can be easily downloaded. There are different methods to calculate the eGFR that are there. And the most widely recommended, my nephrology friends recommend that there is a method called the EPI method, which is again available on the app. So you calculate the eGFR. The calculation of this eGFR is extremely important, one, to categorize the degree of renal failure, because that tells us whether we would be able to do procedures safely, and whether a person would need renal replacement therapy in the form of dialysis in the background or not. For example, if somebody's eGFR is 40 ml, then we multiply it by a factor of 3.75, and we get the total amount of dye that can be safely given to these patients without having to resort to dialysis. On the other hand, if a patient is in absolutely end-stage renal disease where he needs a renal replacement therapy, which means eGFR of less than 15 ml per minute per 1.73 meter square area, then that means these patients are going to anyway need a dialysis. So depending upon the clinical situation, there can be situations where the person cannot undergo dialysis because he's so sick. So in those patients, perhaps our hands are kind of tied down. We can only give dual antiplatelets, plus we can give some blood thinners like enoxaparin. That is all that we can do. However, if the patient's eGFR allows, we can take these patients for an angioplasty. If we have, say, again, it will depend upon what you find when you do an angiography. Most of us can do angiographies now with very low amount of dye. I find that most of the times we use less than 50 ml. In fact, 30 to 40 ml of dye, we are able to do our angiographies all the time. So if upon that we find that in another few ml we would be able to do the angioplasty also, that is the best option. World over, it is now recognized that primary angioplasty is the best option. If your eGFR is reasonable, you are in a scenario where you're not able to do a primary angioplasty, then giving a thrombolytic, as I said, is a better option. Among the thrombolytics, I would like to choose something that is fibrin specific and is less likely to cause intracranial hemorrhage, because these patients would be at a greater risk for intracranial hemorrhage. So I would like to use, say, tenecteplase, which is fibrin specific. It's a single shot bolus. It is rapidly acting, causes less ICH. So that would be my drug of choice. Most of the times, the dual antiplatelet therapy is not a contraindication. It can be safely given. If we have thrombolyzed the patient, then we also have to give enoxaparin to these patients. Again, it has to be modified perhaps in some patients of CKD who have a really low eGFR. There are no standard guidelines as such, but I would believe that it has to be individualized from patient to patient. The other therapies that are concerned, ACE inhibitors and beta blockers and statins. Statins in STEMI, you would treat as you normally do. You have to give initially high dose of statins and continue to give high dose of statins. starting within the first 24 hours of ST elevation MI. ACE inhibitors, again, I firmly believe, at least my nephrology friends do believe, that there is absolutely no contraindication for an ACE inhibitor, no level of creatinine as we commonly believe it is 2 or 2.5 or 3. It is, I find that my nephrology friends use ACE inhibitors at any creatinine levels. The only thing is we have to be able to watch the potassium. If we are able to watch the potassium, then there is no level of contraindication to using the ACE inhibitors. However, for a general physician, for a normal, for a person who is not in a multi-specialty hospital setup and is ready to tackle all the complications, perhaps in those scenarios, and many a times we have patients who cannot get their potassiums done so regularly. So in those scenarios, perhaps a creatinine of 2.25 or 2.5 would be the upper limit where I would safely use an ACE inhibitor. Beta blockers again have to be used as per the requirements of the patient. If there is a tachycardia, you have to use beta blockers, but you have to start with a lower dose in these patients and build up the dose as the heart rate response comes in. Again, there are a lot of precautions that we have to do while we take these patients for angioplasty. If the patient is in heart failure, it is the most tricky situation because you cannot give adequate fluids to these patients. Otherwise, most of the times we say that you start with a saline infusion, which should be started quite well prior to the procedure. Keep these patients hydrated, keep within the limits of the dye load that we can give to these patients, and I guess that is the way these patients are acutely managed.
Very nice, Sandeep. I think you mentioned very clear cut that the contraindication is not always a contraindication.
Right.
We have to individualize our patient.
Right.
See what we can do best for the patient.
Surely.
Because every individual respond in a different manner.
Sure.
I think the way you mentioned that we can give contrast to a limited number of patients, we go by the EGFR. There are some guidelines, there are some criterias, and it depends on in which situation, where, and who is managing the patient.
Right.
Is it a multidiscipline, or it's a small community hospital, or a small center? I think all those limitations are very important, where the facilities are, where the facilities are not. So we should be bold, because we have to see what are the benefit versus hazards.
Sure.
Our therapy can be given, and we should not be in a fear, oh, this patient is of a CKD or a renal failure, I cannot do angioplasty, I cannot do angiography. I think this myth should be out. And the second point, you mentioned very categorically, 10 active place. I still feel to like to ask you, should the dose of TNK should be weight adjusted here, or there is a limitation that we give less dose of TNK like we do in elderlies to prevent the hemorrhagic complication, we sometimes reduce to half the dose. What's your message, take-home message, Sandeep?
See, by and large, we need to give 0.5 milligrams per kilogram of tenecteplase. That is the standard dosage. For the elderly, it has been recommended that if somebody is beyond 75, maybe we could put it down to 70 in our country. If somebody is more than that, then we cut down the dose by 50%, because that leads to lesser incidence of ICH. As far as the renal failure patients are concerned, there are really no recommendations as such. If the patient happens to be older, the same 50%.
So Sandeep is very bold, and he is saying there is no recommendation. Please create your own protocol.
Yeah.
Give it to your patients the full dose, and see who responds in what way. And create your own literature, create your own data.
Sure.
This is a subset of patient which we need more validation. But I think 10 active place can easily be given.
Surely.
Ladies and gentlemen, the message is very clear. The message is manage the STEMI for the sake of STEMI with comorbidity. Comorbidity has to be considered very important, but the STEMI, which is a life taker, we have to save the life in whatever best we can. And I think Sandeep gave a very nice message that it is not only 10 active place or angioplasty or stenting, even the drugs which are used. he was very, very bold in saying that ACE inhibitors is no more a contraindication, even if the creatinine level is high. The only thing which we should keep in mind is measuring the potassium level, which is very important in a tertiary hospital with a huge teamwork. Nephrologist colleagues are there, cardiologists are there, and everybody managed to the best of capability. But in a small hospital, there are limitations. We have to be a little careful. Similarly, beta blockers and diuretics, because all these patients are hemodynamically compromised. And he also gave a situation. If a patient got CKD with STEMI and is in a state of cardiogenic shock, you must take a decision purely on individual basis. But what is the objective? The objective is only one. What best I can do for my patient to get him out from this jeopardy. Thank you, Sandeep.
Thanks.
It was very nice and interacting with you.
Thanks.